Good morning. Hello, everybody. The first thing I was going to do was ask for a special prayer, but Pastor Stacy Harsford just flew in from Richmond, New Hampshire, where she's already done one church service, and she's here to join us for ours. Welcome, Stacy. Glad to have her here. I'm glad to see that there's kids here, because she's going to give a children's sermon later on in our worship service. You know, they write Bible verses for occasions like this. How good and wonderful it is when those who love the world, love the Lord, come together in unity and harmony and praise to our God. Look around you. Look off into the balcony seats there, which are like a little bit lower. And over here in the middle, the orchestra seats and the groupie seats going up. We've got people everywhere. We've got folks on Facebook Live joining us, probably from all kinds of places. I know that on Zoom we have a groupie, I'll admit, from Florida. We have some vacationers tuning in from Colorado, and other regulars tuning in from Connecticut. So we're all over the place this morning, and how wonderful that they can see us coming together to worship together. For those who wouldn't know, let me introduce our other pastors that are joining us this morning. From Sterrett Memorial is Stacy Hartford. She's Sterrett Memorial, and also with the Million Workers up there in New Hampshire. We're getting around too. And then from Athol Congregational is Reverend Candy Ashenden and the Reverend Lee Jones. So we all know at least some of you, and we'll get to know even more of you today. And so I'd like to get us to center our hearts for worship this morning by hearing these centering words. When we give ourselves fully to God, God transforms our lives. And in this transformation, God connects us to others whose lives are being transformed as they too give themselves fully to God. Let us dwell on those thoughts as we listen to the Pandemics once more sing or play. Make those drums sing, "How Great Thou Art." That I am.
You are the Messiah, the Son of God. family of God, as we gather today, the Holy Spirit asks us, who do you say that I am?
You are our comforter, advocate, and sustainer.
Family of God, as we gather today, God our Creator asks us, who do you say that I am?
You are our Creator, provider, and healer.
Family of God, as we gather today, the Triune God asks us, who do you say that I am?
You are love that creates, saves, and holds us into the family of God. May we be instruments of love in all that we are and all that we do. Amen.
Our first hymn this morning, we get to sing with the drums now. And our first hymn, there's an insert in your bulletin, Amazing Grace, which will morph into Ode to Joy. All the words are there for you to sing along in the posture that you're most comfortable in, sitting or standing.
Children, so everyone pay attention. Can we help you? I'm going to need some assistance for this. So first I'd like to introduce you to Plank. Plank was created on a mission trip by one of my youth group children from the Hudson United Methodist Church. And Plank loves people. He went around East Machias. He took pictures with everyone that he met at every store,
every roadside stop we made. Plank is a lover of people. So after worship, if you would like to have your picture with Plank, he would love to have that happen. So that's a little bit about Plank. Well, he has some gifts for all of you children. So let's see. Do you want to come up one at a time and choose a gift? Come to my bag.
Don't be shy.
Come on. Here's a gift for you. Let's see, what does it say? Flower. Oh, I don't know if that's such a good gift. What do we have next? What else does Plank have? Baking soda?
Baking soda.
Who wants baking soda? Anybody? Come on in. All right, we also have... Oh, Crisco? You want some Crisco?
Shortening.
Oh, let's see. Oh, this is a little better. We have some vanilla extract.
Ooh!
You want that? Vanilla extract. And now we have, sugar. Who likes sugar?
No, you like sugar. You like
sugar. Come get the sugar.
I love sugar.
We have one more thing. Hershey chocolate kisses. Oh, that's a good idea. Look at him. Oh, look at that. Plank is a little silly. You see, these gifts by themselves, other than the Hershey's chocolate kisses, aren't so good, are they?
Besides sugar.
But when you take all of these gifts that Plank has given you and you pour them into a bowl and you mix them all up and you stick them in the oven, what might you get?
Cookies.
Cookies, yes! Cookies.
Oh.
Guess what? Plank has some cookies. Who would like to have some cookies? Come up and grab some cookies. You want to pass them out? Make sure everyone gets one. Here, we'll hold this one for you. So, Plank had this silly little game here about giving these gifts because he wants to remind you that we all have wonderful gifts. And sometimes our gifts aren't so great when they're by themselves. But when we come together as a church, guess what? We can be like cookies. How amazing is that? God wants us to come together, just like there are many parts of our body of Christ. They're not so great by themselves. Now, you may be able to walk if you lose a toe or a finger, but you're going to feel a little bit disconnected, correct?
Yeah.
Every part is important, just like every part of these ingredients are important to make cookies. So I want you to remember that every single one of you has a great gift and that God loves you all and he is watching over all of us. Let us pray. Dear loving and gracious God, we ask that you remind us on a continuous basis to come together as Christians. Doesn't matter what church they may attend, but we can come together and we can make cookies and make greatness, and we are so wonderful and whole. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I can take back those not so wonderful gifts unless you want to keep them.
I'm going to keep mine.
You want to keep yours?
If you want to keep it, you can. Or you can keep it back even. Okay, you can keep it.
Thank you, Stacy. So our reading this morning from the epistles is from Romans chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. So here's what I want you to do, God helping you. Take your everyday, ordinary life, your sleeping, eating, going to work, and walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. Embracing what God does for you is the best thing you can do for him. Don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize what he wants from you and quickly respond to it. Unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to its level of immaturity, God brings the best out of you, develops well-formed maturity in you. I'm speaking to you out of deep gratitude for all that God has given me, and especially as I have responsibilities in relation to you. Living then as every one of you does, in pure grace, it's important that you not misinterpret yourselves as people who are bringing this goodness to God. No, God brings it all to you. The only accurate way to understand ourselves is by what God is and by what he does for us, not by what we are or what we do for him. In this way, we are like the various parts of a human body or a cookie. Each part gets its meaning from the body as a whole, not the other way around. The body we're talking about now is Christ's body of chosen people. Each of us finds our meaning and our function as part of his body. But as a chopped off finger or cut off toe, we wouldn't amount to much, would we? So since we find ourselves fashioned into all these excellently formed and marvelously functioning parts of Christ's body, let's just go ahead and be what we were made to be. Without enviously or pridefully comparing ourselves with each other or trying to be something we aren't. If you preach, just preach God's message, nothing else. If you help, just help, don't take over. If you teach, stick to your teaching. If you give encouraging guidance, be careful that you don't get bossy. If you're put in charge, don't manipulate. If you're called to give aid to people in distress, keep your eyes open and be quick to respond. If you work with the disadvantaged, don't let yourself get irritated with them or depressed by them. Keep a smile on your face. May God grant us understanding to this God's holy words.
As Candy shared with you words from Paul to the church at Rome, I'm going to share to you words from Paul to the church in Corinth, from his first letter to the church at Corinth. Just as Paul shared with all the churches these similar messages, these messages mean something and have words for us for leading our lives as well. So hear Paul's words to the church at Corinth and to us. The way God designed our bodies is a model for understanding our lives together as a church. Every part dependent on every other part. The parts we mention and the parts we don't. The parts we see and the parts we don't. If one part hurts, every other part is involved in the hurt and in the healing. If one part flourishes, every other part enters into the exuberance. You are Christ's body. That's who you are. You must never forget this. Only as you accept your part of that body does your part mean anything. You're familiar with some of the parts that God has formed in his church, which is his body. There are apostles, prophets, teachers, miracle workers, healers, helpers, organizers, those who pray in tongues. But it's obvious by now, isn't it, that Christ Church is a complete body and not a gigantic undimensional part. It's all apostles, not all prophets, not all miracle workers, not all healers, not all prayer in tongues, not all interpreters of tongues. And yet some of you keep competing for so-called important parts. But now I want to lay out a far better way for you. Again, words from Paul, similar to the letter to the church at Rome, but for the church in Corinth and for us today. Let us respond to these words from Paul and from Jesus and from God by singing together with the drums, Hallelujah.
This song, I'm listening to the message that our ministers gave us, and this song is very cool. It goes right along with what they're talking about, different parts, because we're going to play this. First, the leads are going to play it by themselves, and then a second part adds, and a third part adds, and a fourth part adds, and at the end, it just sounds fabulous. That one part by itself doesn't sound as wonderful as everybody together. So that's my addition to the service.
Do we sing at all parts, or
why
should we come in?
Why don't you sing at the end when
okay.
It gets full?
All right. Pastor Cindy LaJoy, who is from the Athol Congregational Church.
Yeah. I'm just a wee bit taller.
She's a lot taller than me.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Isn't it kind of amazing to sit here and look out amongst all of us together? And I know we sort of clumped, because that's what we do initially. But we won't be at food time, will we? We won't be clumping at food time, I don't think. So there was a Catholic priest, a Methodist pastor, a Baptist minister, and an Episcopalian rector who were attending an ecumenical conference. After the conference was done and they had supper, they were relaxing in the hotel restaurant. The Catholic priest said, "You know, it's great to get to know one another's theology, but I think it would be even better if we shared some of our human side. Don't any of you have any bad habits? You know, confession is good for the soul, and we'd surely build mutual tolerance, knowing what faults we all share. How about it? The Baptist minister spoke first, saying, I'd have to say that I'm a terrible, terrible alcoholic. I've got a flask in every jacket and gown I have. No, I don't have a flask. Half the time when the secretary tells callers that I'm out tending to my congregation, I'm really face down on my desk, out cold, totally. I can't even tell you the number of baptisms, weddings, funerals, counseling sessions that I've skipped because I was absolutely plastered. The Episcopalian rector nodded gravely and said, well, that can't be worse than me. I'm a terrible, terrible glutton, and I'm completely out of control. I raid my fridge late at night, eat all the junk food I can find, and even have been kicked out of an all-you-can-eat buffet. I grab all the leftovers from every church potluck, then binge on them once I get home. Well, the Methodist minister heaved a sigh and said, I'm afraid I've got that beat. I'm a terrible, terrible embezzler. I'm no good with money, and I've got a taste for high living that my salary just can't satisfy. Each church I've served could have paid down their mortgage like you wouldn't believe if not for me and my awful ways. What a hypocrite I've been, browbeating my hardworking parishioners to pledge more each year while I spent their gifts hand over fist. Finally, the Catholic priest sat there with his steepled fingers and bowed his head. He said nothing. Presently, one of the others said, well, what about you? Don't you have any skeletons at all to share? The priest shrugged and looked up and said, well, I'm a terrible, terrible gossip. Our scripture passages this morning are often used in settings where a congregation is in trouble. Maybe there's infighting over really important issues, you know, things such as the selection of carpet for a sanctuary, or whether children who are fussing should be taken out of worship or not, or even, oh my gosh, if generic coffee can be served during coffee hour rather than brand name. None of you have ever had these kind of silly, like, arguments in your church, I'm sure. A pastor might use these particular scriptures to remind their flock that God wishes for us to live in unity, not disharmony. If anyone has ever been the member of any congregation for very long, regardless of the denomination, you know how heated these topics can sometimes be. So if we can't manage to get along even within our own congregations, how in the world are we supposed to live into Jesus's call that they may all be one? We humans do a pretty darn good job of dividing ourselves, don't we? That is what makes this morning so very special. Each and every one of us here this morning is making an intentional attempt to live into being the church with a capital C, rather than being part of an exclusive club that any individual denomination can sometimes grow to be. We are being open to possibilities and promise, to friendship and collaboration. And most importantly, we are working to recognize that we have far more in common than not, and that Jesus was onto something when in John chapter 1, verses 20 through 23, he is quoted as saying, my prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us so that the world may believe that you have sent me, that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. So that they may be brought to complete unity. Does that seem entirely unattainable? Complete unity, really? In 21st century America, that may sometimes seem almost laughable. And yet, Jesus says it is fully attainable. But how? How do we learn to love and appreciate one another, to accept our differences as something enriching rather than dividing? In a culture that seems hell-bent on creating conflict and separation, how do we go about changing that narrative and leading the way toward connection and community solidarity?
How do we go about viewing ourselves as we truly are in the eyes of God? As brothers and sisters in Christ, bound by faith, connected by the Spirit, but practicing our own traditions in ways that uniquely speak to us, while still respecting the different traditions of our Christian brothers and sisters. And you know how we do that? Oh, Hannah, that's how we do it. For those of you unfamiliar with the term popularized from the children's film Lilo and Stitch, the concept of Ohana comes to us from the Hawaiians and other Pacific Islanders. As the film teaches us, Ohana means family, and family means no one gets left behind or forgotten. Native Hawaiians have traditionally held extended family very close and created wider family by offering dear friends the honorific title of beloved auntie or uncle. Sometimes it happens in churches too. Ohana immediately implies that the needs of family members will be met as everyone works together to support one another in all ways. The word Ohana is imbued with compassion and love, and yet those benefits also come partnered with responsibility to offer that same compassion and love to others. A perfect modern-day example of the creation of Ohana is the story that a lot of us probably know. And this is the story of Wanda Dench. Does anybody recognize that name? You probably will when I share the story. She's a grandma in Arizona who mistakenly sent a text to 17-year-old African-American Jamal Hinton. And she invited him to Thanksgiving dinner, thinking it was her own grandson that she was texting. What started out as an invite in error in 2016 grew into a lovely Thanksgiving tradition, and now Jamal has shared every single Thanksgiving since that day with Wanda and her husband. When her husband passed, sadly, during COVID, Jamal was there for her that next Thanksgiving, making sure his newfound grandma wasn't alone. You see, Ohana isn't limited to blood relatives, but can be found in workplaces, extended families, families, which is family created through friendship, and more. Sometimes it seems as if we have forgotten how to function well in society as the church with a capital C. We're divided into subsets of families that are denominationally connected to the same message, but we often have disdain for the practices of others. After all, if it isn't the way we do it, it has to be wrong, right? Maybe we need some lessons on how to reclaim our familyhood. I have had the unique experience of quite literally teaching what family fundamentally is. My husband and I are the adoptive parents of five wonderful young adults who were all adopted from orphanages in Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan. We have sons and daughters who joined our family as infants and much older children, and whose lives prior to being adopted did not include deeply bonded relationships. We had to concretely teach our 10 and 12-year-old daughters how to hug, because they really didn't know how to. We had to draw family trees to explain what a cousin was, or how grandparents were related. Coming to us as tweens, we had little time to introduce them to what healthy family interactions looked like. And so we sat down every night to watch DVD episodes of The Waltons and Little House on the Prairie, both of which did a terrific job of providing examples of how to handle conflict, how to be fully present and attentive to the needs of family members, and how to set boundaries kindly around negative behaviors. Sounds a lot like what many of us might need to have reinforced, doesn't it? Especially when it comes to dealing with Christians of another flavor. One thing I have learned is that our church connections and relationships are only as powerful as our family training was. If we learned discord at our parents' knees, then we may not even realize we fomented. If we learned compromise and resilience in our families of origin, then we can quite easily put that into practice out in the world. Reaching across denominational divides ought to be simple if one follows the way of Jesus, right? But have you ever noticed just how hard it can be to put Jesus' supposedly simple teachings into practice? Like, love your enemy? Not so easy. Think about a football team for a moment. Each player on the field likely has his or her own ideas about what plays to call and is absolutely convinced that their play is the best one to run. Each team member may be wearing the same jersey, but once ego gets in the way, it might be hard to tell if the opponent is their enemy or their own teammate. The minute any individual player, or shall we add denomination or church, lets their desire to be the superstar win out, all hope for unity is totally lost. The teams that end up having true staying power may have a strong leader, but that leader invites an atmosphere of collaboration where everyone feels they have contributed to an outcome, sort of like today. There are 5 P's we can all remember when we're working toward creating a stronger and unifying Christian voice right here in our town of Athol. The 5 P's may seem simple, but they need to be put into practice with great intention by each and every one of us here today. First one is pray for one another. Pray for the success of each of our congregation's individual ministries and endeavors. Remember, this is never, never a competition. The second P is to have presence with one another. It is restorative and uplifting to spend time in conversation and worship together. The 4 pastors here of the 5 congregations that are represented here today have started to meet once each month just to bounce ideas off each other and to give us a place to share and rest in the presence of one another. It's a place where we can trust one another and where, despite differing backgrounds, we all speak the same lingo, which is the language of the Spirit. Our third P that would enhance our spiritual connection is to be mindful and protect one another. We need to rise to defend our brothers and sisters. We need to publicly celebrate with one another, to inhibit negative comments of others on social media about one another's congregations, and we need to never spread rumors about one another. 4th, we can prepare one another. How much better off would every single congregation here be if we could learn from one another and grow from that wealth of knowledge gained from our interactions? What are we missing out on by not being more deeply embedded in one another's lives? Finally, because our faith is joyful, and Jesus loved a great gathering, we need to party together, people. The group that plays together stays together. And while working alongside one another does create a strong bond, it is the playful moments that create the highlight reels in our minds that make us smile and help us live into loving, warm relationships with one another. Prayer, presence, protection, preparation, and partying. These 5 practices, if we put them into play, can lead our congregations collectively toward the ability to better represent Christ in our community. There has never been a time, never, when people are more desperate to see unity. This gathering today is theology in action. It is a uniting that God always, always calls for, that Jesus preached about, and that we all seek in a little micro way in our families and in our workplaces. No one wants to live in disunity, and yet it takes real intentional action and commitment to create a wider spirit of ohana. Where humans divide, God desires unity. Where humans note differences, God sees similarity. Where humans live in isolation, God calls for community. The church, we sometimes forget, is universal. And it belongs to God, not us. Our family, our ohana, if you will, all of us here today, we're universal. Just as we all belong to God, not only to a subgroup of believers like the United Church of Christ or the Methodists. We are family. We are connected through our understanding of Christ's universal message. The good news isn't only for a particular denomination or flavor of Christianity, that they may all be one. We are taking new steps toward what our Savior has asked of us here today. Let us all continue the work that begins anew here this morning. Amen.
We come now and begin to enter into a time of prayer. Let us begin first with the unison prayer of yearning. Please join me. God of us all, we search for you in the tropical winds, in the churchyards, throughout our community. Make yourself known to us through the giggles of small children, through the sparkle in the eyes of an elder, through the touch of a warm breeze over our shoulders. Turn us ever more fully towards you and open our hearts to you as the bud of a flower slowly opens to the warmth of the sun. For we are yours, O God, and we yearn to flourish in your sight. Amen. Our help, our universal help, is in God, the maker of heaven and earth. God is our rock, a fortress of mercy and grace. And now, because we are indeed Ohana, the body of Christ, a community of differing gifts, each of us is called to give ourselves fully to God and to one another. As we share signs of peace today, remember our connection in call and service to lift and encourage one another. Seek out someone you don't know this morning and greet them with aloha in the name of Christ. Let us pass the peace of Christ.
We have what we call opportunities for study, service, and fellowship. And there's usually a long list of things printed in their bulletin. I tell them to take it home and post it on their refrigerator or their bathroom mirror, sync it up with their electronic calendars. Nobody's told me how to do that yet, but anyway. Syncing paper to electronics, but there are all kinds of things happening in our churches. I know that Athol Congregational, you have a concert on Thursday that we can learn about. I see you folks from my churches. You've got an email on that to explain about the concert. The Orange United Methodist is having a bake sale next Saturday. If you're going up to Red Apple Farm this weekend, look for the South Athol folks. They're going to be selling fried dough up there. I know that Sterrett has things. We all have a lot of things going on in our churches, and it can fill up your social calendar. We also have bulletin inserts regularly in our congregations with lists of people that we're praying for, and I know that all you other congregations do that too. We have many that we're holding in our hearts. We pray for people around the world, for missionaries around the world, we pray for the people who are subject to disasters around the world. I'm sure you've all just heard of another mass shooting down in Florida. We pray for the people who are victims of that, for that community. We pray especially for the people who were part of that. We pray for the hurting in the world, but we also pray for the joys in our world. And so I invite you now to be in a spirit of prayer. I'm going to lead us in some prayer, and we will close. We will bring that prayer to a close with the Lord's Prayer, which we'll all pray together. So let us be in a posture of prayer. Our great God in heaven, we thank you for this beautiful, beautiful day, for the opportunities to come together, to be Ohana, to be family, to recognize cousins from far off and realize that they're more than cousins, they're brothers and sisters, to see folks that we run into in the grocery store or at community events and realize they are worshipers of you as well. These are opportunities for us to recognize each other in public and come together, to then envelop others in the spirit of love that you give to us. We come together to lift our hearts and our minds and our voices in prayer for our community, for our family, for our neighborhoods, for our world. We live in this world, but we are members, we are citizens of your kingdom, and we ask your help to bring those two worlds closer together, to infuse the world we live in now with the kingdom that we aspire to, so that your love, your kingdom is here on earth as it is in heaven. And so today we lift together our voices in prayer to you by repeating the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And so let us sing our prayer with the pandemics. Let us sing together, Kumbaya. You can stand if you'd like, or sit. Dance if you would, around us. Let us sing. Kumbaya. Offering for today.
We are excited to bring this special offering opportunity to our shared churches because we want to extend our family across the seas. You may know that Athol Congregational has been celebrating with the town of Athol 2023 as the year of kindness.
The exciting part that I mentioned that for now is that kindness is going to match our offerings this morning. So we are giving to STUMAS. STUMAS is an acronym for Save the Unreached Minds and Spirits. It's a complicated title, but it started with a vision of one couple. This couple now lives in Barrie and has started this 501c3, but their original country of origin is Liberia. During the Civil War, the woman of this couple her mother started to host, to take in the orphans who were left alone because of the ongoing war. By the end of the war, she had 350 orphans she was housing herself. From that's the background. But now this couple, Esther and Jenkins Miller, have started this organization, and they are a 501c3 here in the U.S., and they have a partner organization in Liberia that they have started that is the workers on the ground there are the grown-up orphans that her mother once cared for. Their goal is to get children off the streets, to bring children into schools. And because they don't have buildings, they have a new program they are starting that is called a Jeep Mobile. And what this is, it's a $3,000 cost, and our dollar goes so far over there. For $3,000 over there, we can start a Jeep Mobile school sponsored by all of us. That will include the Jeep, which has all the equipment and is portable and can go to where the children are. It includes salary for a teacher for a year. It includes solar panels, which allow them to bring electricity so they can access internet and educational resources. It brings all of that, and the stipulation of a child attending that school is that their parents commit to cleaning up the community in which they live. So you can see that it started from the very beginning and it just continues to grow and to circle. Until now, this has been funded by this couple and a couple of their friends who pitched in. So we are taking it on in Athol as a project, and today we are inviting all of you because we hope to say that the community churches of Athol have started a Jeep Mobile school and made a difference in Liberia. And we will send you afterwards pictures. We have ongoing connection. So you will all hear and see where your dollars are benefiting others. So I invite you now to reflect on all of the gifts and the resources you have been given, and to give as you are able. During the next musical offering, It Is Well With My Soul, I invite you to come forward as you are able, or if you wish, hand your donation to somebody else if it's easier to have them come forward. So come and fill our plates with our blessings. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Lord.